guys, thank you so much for tuning back to Urban Tropical. This is Raj and today we are going to talk about Philodendron Verrucosum. Actually, I have forgotten how long ago I bought it. I can always check it for my video. The key thing we're going to talk about is air layering. That's how I have done the propagation this time. And second, lighting and feeding and what happened when I had the leafy yellowing. So actually, I went through quite a lot of problems with it, even though now it just looks stunning and it had gained really good height and it looks fuller. But you know, you learn so much about the plants, and this one is one to be known as not that much easy care. And I find with the plants, it can be really easy care for one person and at the same time it can be nightmare for the other person. So this one is quite prone to spider mites. Actually, I have never experienced any spider mites on it. The only thing I have experienced is thrips on. So if you look at this leaf here, all this is thrips damaged, and actually they kind of bombarded my house. That's how big a problem I had. And I can say now I have a mastered thrips. I know super quick if I have them in my house. There are two telltale signs which I will shoot another video about, but I don't stress about thrips anymore. I have done my fair share on it. But again, when you go through hard time, you learn a lot. Back to Verrucosum. So this one, I really wanted to do air layering, and I'm going to attach the video at the end how I did it, and I'm just going to check how it looks. And let's just do that. I'm a bit nervous as well because I really don't know how the rooting system has taken place, but I find air layering is one of the safest method to do, because even if you don't succeed, you haven't really killed the plant. The only key thing is make sure you keep the media inside moist. I have not used moss. I have used coconut coir. I don't buy moss just for environmental reasons. I'm not judging anyone. If anyone does, it's a personal preference. And the key thing moss does is it retains moisture, and I have used coconut coir. It does the same thing. It retains moisture. And the other thing I did not close at the bottom, one for air circulation, because it's quite cling film all around. I didn't want it to be so tight that plant can't breathe. So there is a hole at the top, there is a hole at the bottom, so if there is any rooting system that can come down. At the same time, there is a really nice airflow, because aeroids, they love airflow, and it's not just aeroids, any plant likes more air. So that was only the key thing to mention. Otherwise, air layering is the easiest method to propagate. This one propagates quite easily in water as well, which I have done. Actually, I didn't shoot video on it, and that plant is doing really well as well. And the thing I'm not sure about is if it has rooted, shall I cut it or not? Because I'm going to have good 1.5 feet long stem. And the reason I did not actually check this earlier, the garden season started. I was so busy on garden plants, just looking after that. This one kind of went out of the window, and now I'm just thinking enough is enough. I'm just gonna either decide to cut it or leave it, or you can help me decide. So in this shoot, I will not be cutting this. Either way, has rooted or not. I just wanted to mention actually one more thing. So if you have seen my very original video, the day I received this or the week I received this, I put it in a pot which has no drainage holes. And what happened was that I put it in my bathroom. That's where I had the highest humidity, because the time I bought this, it was really low humidity. And then I had this leaf yellowing issues. What I meant by leaf yellowing was that I will get a lot of yellow rings around it. That's a sign of inconsistent watering, or there is some fungus issues I have in my soil, which has been activated because I was not good at watering. What it could was always there, I triggered it. So either way, I had a problem. And the most recommended method on Google is for fungus, is you use baking soda and you use water. And I did that, and all my leaves got burned. Actually, I used really low dosage just to be safe. So I used it on my anthurium, which did absolutely fine. Again, some plants can react really bad to it, some good. So if you end up using baking soda on any of your plants, I will highly recommend that test it on one section or on one leaf. And actually, you see the results literally within a day or two. That's how effective baking soda is. either it's going to cure it or it's going to just burn it. So either way you are going to know. So I will really emphasize back on, you see baking soda, it does not work the same on every single plant. Even my clathias did not take well to that orbifolia. I was getting the same yellow ring which I used, and it literally burned my leaf the next day, so I had to cut them all. So again, I just wanted to let you guys know in case, because it's really painful to see all the leaf yellowing. Second, these ones are quite sensitive to watering, and because I didn't have any drainage and I was thinking maybe that's what causing all these issues, so I just bought a clear pot. And the benefits of a clear pot, one, I can see how the moisture level is inside. If it's like, if you see all these sweat signs, that means there is water inside. I can relax, I don't need to water it, so I don't overwater it. Second, I'm always keen to see how my rooting system is doing. And once it starts to fill up with the roots, I will see it all around. So that's why I really, really actually like the clear pot for this one. And third thing, actually, given the size of this plant, it does not have a huge rooting system. So when I potted this one up in here, this was the rooting system. So it's half root, half soil. I don't think that I need to change it, at least for next year's summer. That's what I am really hoping. And in terms of lighting, this one is supposed to be in kind of indirect bright light, or they say you can still do in kind of a mediumish light. And I find that when I moved it to south facing side of my house, so this is my kitchen, it has a high humidity, and this is a south facing, so it gets really baked in the sun. And this plant is here, which is approximately 10 centimeter away from this main door. That means it gets sun most of the day and it gets the most intense sun, but I did not have a single leaf scorch. So there is always this thing we hear about plants, they are at the bottom of the tree, they like kind of part shade, so don't put them in direct sun. And actually that did not happen to be true with my plant at all. Again, at the same time, I say one plant does really well in with the different people, so I don't want you to burn your plant because I'm saying it. You can always check it, so if you think the leaves are burning, you can move it a bit away. But I just put it right next to here and it did so well. So when I started this process, that was approximately 6 weeks ago, I started to air layering, and this was the leaf I had, and this leaf was kind of still unfurling. Actually, I'm going to put the video at the bottom and then you can see exactly how small this plant was at the time. And it just went on and on. So now we come down to, if I'm giving it a sunlight, that means now it needs feed to sustain the growth. So in terms of a feed, I normally use a seaweed and I have got worm castings in it. Sometimes I get lazy and I thought I'm not gonna make the seaweed solution. This is such a handy, so if I'm feeding my orchids, which actually I bought first, I wouldn't say I bought them first time this year, I have bought them many times, maybe I buy every other year one pot and they always die from me. But this time I have made the resolution that I must keep them alive and I never buy orchid feed. How am I supposed to keep them alive? But enough is enough, so I bought orchid feed. So whenever I'm feeding orchid, which is pretty much every week, I do really weak feed, I feed the plant at the same time. And this is really weak solution because fertilizing, over fertilizing is so easy to do. I can kill this. I mean, I don't want to kill this beauty, right? So I just end up using this because it's so weak solution and I know I can't overdo it. I know I can't kill you, but never say never, right? So this has done great. I'm not recommending that you go and get orchid feed. Any feed will do as long as you don't overdo it. If you underdo it, you can do it more often. If you overdo it, you can't do it again for a really long time and you have to flush it all out. How do you know you have over fertilized your plant? As soon as you fertilize it, within 24 to 48 hours, the bottom of the leaves starts to go really yellow because the oldest root absorbs the nutrition first. That's how it works in plants, and that's a sign that you have over fertilized your plant. But not to worry there, just take it to the bathroom, or if it's raining, put it out, let the rain wash it through, or do it in your bathroom, run the shower, just let it flush all out its nutrition, then you know at least you have done your bit to save it. Okay, so now let's check air layering, if it has worked or not. The key thing to keep in mind is that I have left a hole right there, so when I make this wet, it can release down, so no water can stay here. At the same time, if there is any root, it can come down and I can see. I don't think I see much rooting system. It's been 6 weeks. I should see something, right? But let's see in case they're just hidden. Okay, let's just do it. I'm a bit nervous. I'm just gonna cut it all out here. Okay. Actually, I'm so surprised the way coconut is sticking to it. Gone around the stick, that's why it's taking me a bit longer. Okay, yeah, actually I'm a bit paranoid now. If it's got too much roots, shall I cut it or not? Oh dear, I think it's got really good rooting system, or I have just got coconut coir so badly stuck to it. This is all the roots. Oh dear. I think it has got really good rooting system. I am thinking, shall I cut it or not now? Okay, so what I'm going to do is, I am going to post this video and I'm going to wrap it back up because I'm not sure what to do. Please help me here. I really don't want to cut this long stem. The reason I don't want to cut this long stem, I just think it's gone so long that it might not survive, but it has got really good rooting system. But let's just get to the rooting system first and then we can decide if that is a good idea or not. I mean, if the coconut coir is not falling down, that means it's been captured really well with the roots. So there is one root here I can see. There is another root here I can see. Even I can see the white roots, which are pretty new ones. And I have got really big rooting system here. It's really thick. Actually, I'm damaging more roots now than I am trying to save any. So these are all the roots here. So I'm just gonna take the camera and bring it really close. Okay, so these are all the roots here. All these white things, if I can get in focus, are all the roots here. These ones are all the roots here. So this one is actually really big root. Now you can see it's getting all these secondary roots as well. So these ones are roots as well. And on this side I have the same, the roots. Let's just clear. And all these are roots. So now I think I should really cut it. It should survive. How big it is if I just do that. So that's how long stem we're talking. I think it's approximately maybe half a meter tall, easily half a meter tall. I don't know if I should really cut this or not. So please advise. I don't know which way to go. No idea. So separate. But anyway, thank you so much for tuning in and I really hope that it was worth it. Anyway, thank you so much for tuning in and I really hope that it was helpful. At the same time, if you can help me here, that'll be great. So I'm just gonna post this video tonight. Thank you. Bye-bye.